Hi, and welcome to Chapter 13 on using technology to manage information. Obviously, this is a critical chapter for those of you who are interested in pursuing a major in computer information system or management information system. Very lucrative area with endless demand and one of the fastest growth out there. So if this is for you, well, hopefully this little intro chapter here we'll give you just a broad brush, nothing too deep. Let's get going with the table of content. So we'll look at how information technology transform business and managerial decision making, why computer networks are an important part of today's information systems, the types of systems that make a company's management information system, MIS. We'll look at technology management and how they help companies plan to optimize their information technology system. Bill Gates had an interesting quote about that, is that basically technology will enhance a company that has a very efficient system. But reversely, technology can amplify the inefficiency of a company if it's inefficient. So remember, you still have to have a sound company, a sound system as you augment it with information technology. What are the best ways to protect computers and the information they contain? And we'll look at some of the new trends in info technology. Pretty straightforward chapter, by the way. So maybe we'll get it done in maybe 30 minutes. So very simple definitions here. Information technology includes the equipment and techniques used to manage and process information. If you think about where we are today, in less than 70 years, we've shifted from an industrial society to a knowledge-based economy driven by information. You know, I just can't help but whenever I see a quote like that, again, just kind of encourage you for doing the right thing, which is what you're doing now by working on your education. You're to be part of the knowledge-based economy that is the United States and most developed countries, you have to have the knowledge. Education gives you the knowledge. And so keep it up, you're on the right track. By the way, I'm following along with your book. So page 501 is the beginning of this chapter. There are two tables here to help us summarize the types of computer equipment, software, etc. Let's just check it out. So table 13.1 is just business computing equipment. You know, basic stuff. You know, what are the description, what are the comments, the tablet, the desktop, the laptop, you know, etc. So just basic definitions on that. And then for the software, now that we looked at hardware, obviously lots of software here, because you're business majors, a lot of these are going to be really critical to you. Of course, Microsoft Word, word processing type software. Spreadsheets, I always think, is one of the most critical for business majors. If you master Excel, you're going to love life. And you know, Excel is just such an astounding tool that helps you manipulate all kinds of different variables and data into the kind of information that you want. If else formulas, lots of stuff. You can even embed coding within Excel if that's something you needed. Database management programs, very important. Client list, how to manipulate your client lists. You know, it's gold when you have a good solid database with information about, you know, your customers, your inventory, and crossing out the both. You can start to really get intelligible information about you know, purchasing habits, who buys what, when, how much, with what. Lots of information, you know. So again, data by itself is just overwhelming, and these tools help turn data into actionable information. Graphic and presentation programs, so you know, tablets, graphs, etc. So again, there's different programs for that. Desktop publishing to create different types of advertising, layouts, magazines, whatever. Communication programs, I think right now all of us are very familiar with them during this COVID pandemic. Integrated software suites, think about, you know, again, Microsoft is an example, Microsoft Office. Groupware. I know you're probably a lot of you are using Groupware with your companies. I know you're working on group projects in your class where you are using that. And of course, lots of financial software out there, Quicken, QuickBook, etc. All right, so now we're getting into how InfoTech transformed business and managerial decision making. So you have these positions that didn't used to exist. Today, one of the most critical person in the C-suite is the CIO, the Chief Information Officer. Their responsibility is managing all of the information resources. Many companies, the CIO gets promoted to CEO. A good CIO is so critical to the company that often they get credited with the success of the company and get promoted to CEO. The importance of this responsibility is immense. In addition to the massive expansion of information gathered by today's business, most of us are knowledge workers who develop or use the knowledge. And so again, that's why it's such a critical position. MIS, Management Information System, are the methods and equipments that provide information about all aspects of a firm's operations and provide managers with the information they need to make decisions. So database, e-filing system, there's all kinds of things out there that lend themselves to that. So why are computer networks important of today's information technology systems? First, let's look at definitions. A computer network is a group of two or more computers linked together by communication channels to share data and information. The one that you're probably most familiar with is the local area network. Maybe you have that at work. We have, of course, one at Chafee. Lets people at one site exchange data and share the use of hardware and software from a variety of computer manufacturers. The internet is essentially a worldwide WAN, right? Which is the next one. Connects computers at different sites via telecom, etc. And then we're getting into the intranet. So this is, what you'll have at your company, which is a type of LAN. Private corporate networks that operate behind a firewall. Firewall, of course, designed to keep the bad guys at bay. And sometimes, your employees don't just click on an email because you get a notice that, your bank is telling you some horrible news and you think, oh no, I need to click on it. And you're so stressed out, you're not paying attention to what you're clicking on and you're a victim of a phishing attempt is what they're called, right? Where now they have your password and all that stuff and it was never your bank, even though the webpage looked just like the email looked like it came from your bank. So enterprise portal, internal website that provides proprietary corporate information to defined user group. And then you got the VPNs. I'm sure many of you have VPNs at home, used to connect two or more private networks over a public network such as the internet. They're popular because of the security they provide. And sometimes they're not popular because they slow things down depending on how they're set up. So let's look at the next exhibit showing that the VPN uses existing internet infrastructure to remote users and offices almost anywhere in the world. So there's your client and there's your server, your local ISP, a public network, and back to your server all very securely. Why are computer networks an important part of today's InfoTech system? So the application system providers, the ASP, offer different approach to this problem, and companies subscribe usually on a monthly basis to ASP or use the application much like you use voicemail or technology which resides at the phone company. So other names for that include on-demand software, hosted application. The next exhibit will show you how it interfaces with software and hardware. The managed service providers represent the next generations of ASPs, offering greater customization and expanded capabilities that include business processes and complete management of the network servers. It's one of the fastest growing markets, as you can see here, at $255 billion in 2021, was $166 billion in 2017. So, again, these are the areas that you might want to kind of consider as you're looking at your majors and if this is something that you're interested in. There's a tremendous amount of growth. Chafee has a fantastic program, by the way. Okay, so here we go. So you have your users, you have your IT department, your ASP that connects you with developers, hardware vendors, software vendors. So you can basically, you don't have to upgrade your stuff every 5 seconds. Okay, what type of systems make up a typical company's management information system? And so what we have here, the job of managing company's info needs fall on to management info system. And those include the users, hardware, software that support decision making. And so we'll look at the next screen over here for relationship between transaction processing and management support system, as well as the management levels they serve. A firm's integrated information system starts with its transaction processing system, the TPS, which receives raw data from internal and external source and prepares its data for storage in a database similar to a microcomputer database, but larger. So this is what it looks like. You've got the operational here, you got the middle here, and you got the executives here. So you're converting all of this information into possible solution, executive information system, and external database having access to that as well. So when you take the management class, you'll learn about environmental scanning, where the executives, upper management, are always looking at the external environment and the internal environment of the company and trying to leverage internal strengths to take advantage of external opportunity. And so in this particular case, this kind of tool right there, the company's integrated information system helps connect the dots, make that possible. All right, then we're getting into the management support system. They use the internal master database to perform high-level analysis that help manager make better decision. And then outside, data warehouses that combine the database across the whole company into one central database that supports management decision making. And so then they go into data marts, which are subsets of a data warehouse with a single area of data, and they're organized for quick analysis. So this is where you could have a data mart for your marketing data, one for your financial data, etc. Then we're getting into decision support systems. They help managers make decisions using interactive computer models that describe real-world processes. They also use data from internal database, but look for specific data that relate to the problem at hand. I decided to share with you a clip here from the Center for Disease Control about how this data is used for immunization to make sure that, of course, everybody gets immunized at the right time. And in terms of prioritization, I mean, that is a massive, massive task. So these are the what-if questions. And so in this case, of course, the most slammed people, the heroes are the healthcare worker, the nurses, the doctors, etc. So this is a clip that I just got here. It's a little bit technical, but you'll get the gist from the Center for Disease Control and how they use DSS, Decision Support System, for immunization.
What recent advances have truly impacted the way you work and live? Making tasks that used to be time-consuming and complex faster and easier. It wasn't that long ago when mail was carried by pigeon post, taking several days or even weeks to get to its destination. Compare that with today's email, delivered almost instantly around the globe. And what about advances in photography? In the past, you typically had one shot to make a moment count.
Fiddlesticks.
Now, with digital photography, you blinked.
Okay, I got it.
The perfect pic is just a click away. Times have sure changed, but what about the field of immunization? Are you aware of the advances in technology that can make your job easier? Clinical Decision Support for Immunization, or CDSI, provides those technological advances through the creation of three resources: logic specification, supporting data, and test cases. CDSI resources help save time by translating the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices clinical recommendations into technical logic. That will make the daunting task of updating your clinical decision support engine a lot easier to swallow. The logic specification describes the functionality needed to evaluate and forecast based on a patient's immunization history. The supporting data are structured representations of ACIP recommendations. and the test cases validate the recommendations delivered by CDS engines. These CDSI resources facilitate consistent implementation across a variety of CDS engines, accommodate new and changing ACIP recommendations, and simplify the process of evaluation and forecasting. Bottom line, CDSI resources are designed to make your job easier, quicker, and more efficient, which in turn helps ensure patients receive the right immunization at the right time. So what are you waiting for? Head to the CDSI website to learn more.
Moving on to the next one, although similar to a DSS, an executive information system is customized for an individual executive. These systems provide specific information for strategic decision. For example, a CEO's EIS may include special spreadsheets that represent financial data, comparing the company to its competitors, you know, this would be a benchmark, and graphs showing current economic and industry trends. So this would be the external data. An expert system gives managers advice similar to what they would get from a human consultant. Artificial intelligence enables computers to reason and learn to solve problems in much the same way humans do, using what-if reasoning. So for this one, I have a little clip here again, showing you what a dashboard looks like. So these are dashboards are not just for CEOs, they're for all kinds of executives, but they're really a way of turning a lot of data into something really actionable and concise for executives to make a decision. It turns data into information.
To make the best decisions, you need to know what's happening in your business right now, whether you're a sales manager like me,
a VP like me,
or CIO like me. We all need to see real-time information.
And Smartsheet dashboards give us the insights we need to make better decisions faster.
My dashboard gives me a real-time view of our sales pipeline, so I can adjust my plans quickly to keep my team on target. I can see our critical metrics and drill down for the details I need, and make data-driven decisions like which prospects to focus on next. And I can build the exact dashboard I need without help from IT. And I'm always in the loop, even when I'm out on calls.
As VP of sales, I keep a constant eye on how we're tracking to revenue goals. With Smartsheet, it's all at my fingertips.
As CIO, I need a high-level view of multiple projects so I can track budgets, progress, and open issues, and easily share with our board of directors.
Across our company,
information is power.
Smartsheet dashboards make real-time insights accessible to everyone,
so we can all make better decisions
faster.
All right, so I hope you found that useful. Again, I'm trying to add these to, make things a little bit more applicable, relevant, and interesting. Whereas information management involves collecting, processing, and condensing information, the more difficult task of knowledge management focuses on research, gather, organize, and share the company's collective knowledge to improve productivity, foster innovation, and gain competitive advantage. Some companies are even creating a new position, which is chief knowledge officer, to head up this effort. Again, you could see how things are moving so quickly and how much there is in terms of development. The best ways to protect computers. And so, you know, of course, everybody by now is familiar with viruses, spam, all that stuff. So the most costly categories of threat include worm, virus, Trojan horses, computer theft, financial fraud, unauthorized network access. So the firms take steps to prevent these costly computer crimes and problems, which fall into several categories. So you have long paragraphs in your book here. I'll let you read each on your own, but you get an idea for unauthorized access and security breaches, computer viruses, worms, Trojan horses, deliberate damage, spam, software, and media piracy. My son's middle school was actually fell victim to that, where the somebody hacked into the entire district and I guess held the school hostage for a while in terms of if you don't pay us a certain amount, we'll delete all the information. And somehow they resolved it. I don't know how, but it got resolved. But we were getting emails and announcements for a couple of weeks. you know, it was tough. Thousands of kids not having access. Areas of concern regarding the protection of data. Again, so you look at the percentages in terms of area of concern, and you can see what the rankings are here. I'm not going to, you know, again, what are the procedures to protect IT assets? There's lots of procedures here. I'm not going to ask you to memorize all that stuff. Lastly, what are the leading trends in infotech? Cyber sleuthing, you know, is one of the big ones, right? So this is, you know, looking at finding data, finding how the data originated in terms of who perpetrated whatever type of digital crime. So what helped investigators bring suit against Enron, Merck, Vioxx, Medication, and the BTK serial killer? All of that was digital evidence collected from them. There we go. Digital forensic is what I was struggling to remember. So the cyber sleuthing is really called digital forensic. Smaller companies can turn to grid or cloud computing is the other new development. This is a really, really big deal. I wanted to share with you some of the big ones here from Ziff Davis publication. And so Ziff Davis is a, you know, obviously a big publication for anything having to do with the technology. So here's a cloud computing 2020, more mature, going multi-cloud, more focused. And this is the future. I mean, it's already happening, but it's the future. And the company that's really been the company to kind of lead in this effort has been Amazon. That's the leader. Microsoft second, Google third. China's Alibaba is coming up in third, and you know, Oracle and IBM just catching up. Tencent is a very fastly rising, up and coming Chinese company that's trailing, but the growth of Tencent in the past year has surpassed that of these three here. Anyway, so that's just giving you a little bit of an update there. So cloud and grid technology provides a way to divide the job into many smaller tasks and distribute them to virtual supercomputers consisting of many small computers linked to a common network. That's cloud. The next exhibit shows you a typical grid and cloud setup work and the differences. So there you go. On the left, there's your grid, normal, you know, control server with some nodes. And here, cloud computing with everything kind of, you know, going back and attached to it. And that's it for us. That's we did it, actually. 23 minutes, we were able to finish the whole thing. So I hope that you got a lot out of this. And I'll see you guys on the next one.